Hello, I'm Bill Monroe, and welcome to episode 130 of 2 Minute Talk Tips, the podcast that opens with a practical public speaking tip in the first 2 minutes before getting into a deeper discussion about public speaking. Today's tip comes to us from special guest Jason Jordan.
First couple of words out of your mouth, do not make them an apology. So often people get up there, well, I didn't have a whole lot of time to prepare this, or I didn't have a whole lot of time to do this, or I'm really struggling with this. It's an apology. And what it really is, if you dig under, like, why would somebody walk up to the front of the room and start with that? Well, it's an appeal for pity is what it is. It's I'm appealing to the audience to take pity on me because I'm not as prepared as I should be, or this might be a letdown. You know what? Let the audience make up their own mind about whether or not they're engaged in this presentation. You just get going. Don't apologize. Don't beg for mercy. Don't say anything other than here's where we're starting and start with power. And I see everybody do that. A lot of people start off with an apology or something like that. I even saw, as we discussed earlier, the talking heads at Apple when they got up there to introduce the iPhone 10, the most revolutionary product in Apple's history since the first iPhone. And they started with an apology about how they were up late last night burning the midnight oil in preparation for today. And I would just encourage people, don't do it.
Stick around, and after the break, we'll hear more from Jason Jordan. Welcome back. I often talk about the why of your talk. Why are you delivering it? Why are you there? What is it you want the audience to do? Why are you bringing that up? If you don't have a reason for the things that you're talking about, or if you don't have a reason for the things that are on your slide, or you don't have a reason for your talk to begin with, then why are you just wasting everybody's time by delivering it? You've got to cut out the stuff that you don't have a solid why for. You've got to figure out just what it is you want to do there, just what it is you want that audience to do with the things that you are talking about. If you don't, you're just wasting everybody's time. Jason Jordan thinks about why a lot too, but it's on a even bigger scale. You see, he helps organizations and individuals craft their fire story, and that's sort of the story that drives them at their core. It can be a cause close to their hearts, or it could be based around a moment in time that irrevocably altered their future for both better and worse all at the same time. It could be a key relationship that drove them, or a key value that drives them to do what they do. But that core why, that core element makes up the fire story for an individual or an organization. And your fire story evolves over time. My fire story currently focuses, of course, around the morning of June 3rd, 2017, when I found myself whisked away to the hospital that I would live in for the next month. And then the changes that happened in my life since then, the things that I've learned and the passion I was able to focus on helping others to share their stories. Well, this week, Jason shares his story, and he talks about shaping those fire stories that we all have. He talks about his approach to crafting a speech that will utterly terrify novice speakers, and about the impact of forensics, or speech and debate, on his life. And of course, just why those fire stories matter. So now, let's meet Jason. So Jason, thank you so much for joining us here on 2 Minute Talk Tips this week.
It's my absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for having me, though.
Yeah, I mean, I am really excited about your story and the things that you're involved in and the ideas of fire stories, which we'll get into a little bit later. But first, let's go back to the beginning. What's sort of your earliest memory of speaking or performing for groups of people?
That's a great question, Bill. It's so funny how it really what you want to do with the rest of your life hits you at a very young age, and sometimes you just don't recognize it. I was in third grade. I actually grew up in Canada. And in the third grade, they allowed you to do your first speech in front of your class. And then in fifth grade, you were allowed to, the winner from each class was allowed to go in front of the school. And even though I was in third grade, I gave a speech on the American bald eagle, which was a lot of fun for a Canadian audience, and gave the presentation to the class. And they liked it so much, they allowed me to compete with the fifth graders in front of the whole school.
Oh, wow.
And I just remember everybody being so terrified. And I got up there and it was just so cool because all the rest of the school and all the parents, there were probably 200 people in the crowd. And just looking out there, I was in love. I could not get enough of that. And it was really such a challenge to find opportunities to find my way in front of an audience. Whereas everybody else was avoiding it, I couldn't wait to do it.
As a third grader, were you really into the eagle to begin with, or were you really into the idea of just having something to get up and talk about?
Well, like a typical third grader, you know, I think my mother sort of stepped up and helped me with the idea of what to do it about. And, you know, when you're in third grade, the idea of this great big eagle swooping down and snatching fish and all the amazing things that the eagles could do, that was pretty fascinating. I think I probably would have done it about sharks if she had pointed that out to me as well. So
you always enjoyed it then and were able to then pursue it more in school.
I did. My speech teacher in high school, a man named Ralph Bender in Dayton, Ohio at that point, always used to tell the story about how I came walking in freshman year of high school. I was 4'9", this little tiny guy. And I came in and I dropped my bag down and I plopped in his chair and I looked at him and I said, I've been waiting for this class my entire life. And that was speech one. And I took speech two and debate and extemporaneous speaking, and I competed throughout the state, went to state finals, national finals, all those great things. I was in from the word go.
Speech and debate programs, the forensics programs in high school and college are just so key. I mean, that's really where I cut my teeth doing speaking in high school, in oral interp and debate, and then in college covering pretty much all of the events. And you know, that's the stuff that I really took with me from education later into life, was my experiences with that team and with those skills.
Absolutely. So many people avoid it like the plague. Then they end up in the professional world. And this is what you see, really. This is why 99% of the presentations you see in the business world involve 50 PowerPoint slides with little bullet points running across them, and then people just read you the bullet points. It's because nobody's trained in this stuff. Nobody knows what to do, and we procrastinate until the last possible second. You absolutely have to be up there in front of, and by that point, it's your company, it's potential investors, it's potential clients. The stakes are very high. Not really the right place to start. You should already be great at it at that point.
Right. And you don't have necessarily the greatest examples either as you're starting out in your career.
Oh, absolutely not. Everybody has just wholeheartedly embraced the technological world. What's really fun is when the computer or the hookup or the projector doesn't work, and then everybody has a panic attack because they don't know what to do without their technology. And it's only getting worse as we're becoming more and more addicted to our phones and our pads and our laptops. People don't connect one-on-one as effectively as they even used to.
I think one of the biggest demonstrations of some of the flaws in modern speaking is that people use the term presentation to refer to their PowerPoint file or their slide deck. You know, can you send me the presentation? It's like,
right.
No, I can't. Presentation exists at a place in time and space. I can send you the slides for it, but I can't send you the presentation.
That's right. If you're lucky, I shot a video of it. How about that? Exactly. People always get so annoyed when they ask me for my slide deck and they get it because they're expecting 50 slides with every single thing that I said. And what they get is 8 pictures and the rest was me talking.
And, you know, and the other thing is I found is that most of the people who ask me for my slides after a presentation, they never actually look at them. They just want to have them. It's a way of sort of connecting or thinking they're going to go back to them, but they're never going to go back to those slides 3 weeks later.
That's right. I know I never have. It's more like a security blanket, I think.
So these days, before you get up and take a stage and start doing your presentation, what are you sort of doing in the 5 minutes before all of that gets started?
That's another good question, Bill. And I'm going to bring you back to your probably high school days of competing in speech competitions. I'm a purely extemporaneous speaker. This is something that I have practiced and honed in for years leading up to this. And it's a big word. Most people don't know what it means. You probably do since you competed in high school. But you know, on one end of the spectrum, you have impromptu speaking, which is speaking off the cuff or speaking without any preparation at all. That's one end of the spectrum. The other side is what most other people will do, which is kind of a fully prepared, written out, memorized, scripted, to the point where even gestures and movement and all that stuff are scripted and written out and rehearsed and practiced for weeks and months ahead. I'm an extemporaneous speaker, which is that bit in the middle, which is you're basically working off an outline, nothing more. You have ideas of what you want to do, and maybe some sections have been prepared, but for the most part, when it's delivered live and in person the first time, that's the first time it's given. So when you ask what the final 5 minutes before I take stage are, I'm generally still interacting with the people in the crowd because I'm still trying to get any final ideas for their perspective, their pain, their understanding of whatever subject matter I'm covering. And then everything is shaped in the moment to what the crowd is experiencing also in the moment. And it's not for the faint of heart, and I certainly wouldn't recommend it to most people, but it's just something that I've practiced and rehearsed and honed in for years.
And that's important. And what I think is really key there is it makes it sound like, yeah, you're pulling this all together on the fly, sort of winging it, but that's not what's happening. You're working with stuff. You, like I said, you've done this for years. You've honed in on it. You've practiced. You've done your prep work. Your prep work didn't consist of writing out the script for that event, but of building out that base of knowledge and learning how to adapt to all those different members of that audience. And I imagine, too, that as you go from event to event, all of that stuff that's custom for the audience, you're hearing a lot of those same things from other audiences as well and building up those experiences.
Absolutely. And you piece them all together and they weave into this fine fabric that is in large part the same. It can be sometimes 70, 80% the same, sometimes less. But then a lot of the pieces can come together that are very specific. It's really fun when you can pull out individuals in the audience and talk about a conversation that you may have had with them 10 minutes before. And it just changes the nature of the presentation. People think, wow, this is super fresh and super dialed in. This is just for us. This is a special experience that we're sharing. And I really love that part of speaking.
This has taken you years to get to this point. If somebody wants to start sort of taking that approach now, how would they get started with trying to make their presentation a little more extemporaneous, a little bit more focused on that audience?
Well, I would say number one thing that you can do is you get involved with a Toastmasters club, which, I mean, that's a nationwide, actually a worldwide organization. So that provides you with the opportunity regularly to speak, and it provides you with an audience. However, the Toastmasters program is pretty traditional. It's kind of a write it out. Here's your introduction, your three main points, and your conclusion. They wholeheartedly encourage you to write it out, memorize it, and practice it for weeks ahead of time, which I agree with, especially if you're brand new, if you need to get going, and if speaking scares the daylights out of you. You definitely need that practice and that rehearsal to get yourself comfortable. But once you get past that point, what a lot of people will do in Toastmasters is they'll continue along the same path. They'll continue rehearsing and honing the same skills. You have to force yourself to take a new path. You have to actually say, okay, today I'm going to have somebody give me the subject that I'm going to talk about today at my Toastmasters club an hour beforehand. And then I give myself an hour to prepare my presentation from the time it's given to me to the time I hit the front of that stage. I have an hour. And that's the beauty of Toastmasters, is even if you don't do a great job, which the first couple of times you're not going to do a great job, it's going to be rough and uncomfortable, and you're going to forget what you're saying. You'll lose your train of thought. You'll go under time, over time. It'll be really complicated. But Toastmasters is a very forgiving place. People will work with you and they'll embrace you as you go along the separate path and cheer you on, and they'll be support for you no matter how you do. And then as you progress and get better and better at it, well, then they'll all be amazed that you only put 30 minutes of work into the entire presentation.
That's awesome. And if you are going to have a presentation fail, if you are going to screw something up, you want it to be at a group like Toastmasters and not in front of the executive team at your company.
100% yes, Bill. Why people will wait until everything is on the line before they practice speaking is beyond me. Everything counts on that moment when you're up there on the stage, and you want to be as sharp as you can, but that sharpness starts years before. It's a skill. It's a skill, and it has to be developed. You can't fake it.
Right. And I think what's key there is that it's a skill that has to be developed, but more importantly, it's a skill that can be developed.
Oh, without a doubt. Anybody can become a great speaker. And there's lots of tips and so forth out there, but you also have to kind of find your own path and your own comfort zone. I've known phenomenal speakers who say a lot. And in Toastmasters, of course, they teach you about crutch words and they try and pull that out. That's totally good. That's great foundation for communication. You don't want to have a lot of crutch words. But I've also seen some people who make it work for them. And if that's your particular style and you can develop and hone it and you're comfortable with it and your audience is so comfortable with it, they don't even notice it, that's great too. But you got to find your own style for sure.
Right. And one of the things I think is really important when you're talking about things like crutch words and other habits that folks have is that you're in much better position to use that stuff if you're using it deliberately and consciously. Where I think folks get in trouble is when they go on autopilot and they're doing these things that they don't even know about and that they're not really trying to do. And that's when it can become distracting, when it's just purposeless stuff.
Absolutely. And you use the perfect word. It does become distracting. And you need that feedback from a variety of audiences for them to say, hey, look, you know, you said 142 times, and that was really distracting to me. And it's not just if you're in front of an audience presenting. I've worked with a number of people who do webinars. And what's funny is the crutch words in a webinar really ramp up. I was working with a technology company and I went back through some of their earlier webinars and they were averaging 500 crutch words in a half an hour presentation.
Wow.
There were almost no actual words. It was all ums and likes and you knows. And you know as well as I do, they were attempting to do the webinar and type on the computer and work a demo at the same time.
Yeah.
Which is why all the ums came out. But
that's
fine. Nobody bothered to tell them.
500 in a half hour, the average human speaking speed is about 100 to 120 words a minute, which means 4 minutes of that 30-minute presentation was ums and crutch words and wasted time.
Solid. Absolutely.
The other way you find out about the crutch words you use a lot is when you also start hosting your own podcast and then start doing your own editing and can actually start reading your ums and your fantastics and your absolutelys right in the waveform of your own speech. Not that I would know anything about that.
Well, I've got a tuned ear to that sort of thing, and you're doing just great, Bill.
Awesome. Awesome. That'll save me several minutes later down the road. The other thing that I think is really key there that you talked about is with Toastmasters talking about the basics of, you know, your intro, your 3 points, your conclusion, writing it out details, those foundations. A lot of folks seem to think, whether they're looking at speaking or rules of grammar or rules of design, why do I need that stuff? Why does that stuff matter? I'm a creative thinker. I'm an original thinker. I don't need to do that stuff. What I have found is that if you're going to break the rules and if you're going to do something different, you can't go ahead and break the rules and restructure things until you first know the rules and know the structure and know what works traditionally, because then you can more effectively make decisions about what you're going to do and why you're going to do it.
Absolutely. You have to feel the pain before you can break it. You have to know where the problems and where the challenges are. And it's got to be authentic. If you haven't done your homework, back when I used to do sales presentations, the presenters who had clearly never been in the field before and had clearly no earthly idea what their audience was experiencing, they were never successful. No matter how engaging and dynamic of a speaker they were, there was authenticity in somebody who had actually carried the bag. And you're absolutely right. You have to know the rules before you can break them.
And the other thing too, when you talk about those speakers who don't know their audience, who don't know, don't have that experience, a lot of times you can address that simply enough by asking the person who invited you to speak beforehand, what are folks concerned about? You just ask some of those basic questions. And sure, it's not the same as having carried that bag yourself, but you can get a little bit more of an idea if you just ask those basic questions.
You can, and really dig into where that pain lies. I gave a presentation at a security conference. I was a keynote at it. And this was all high-level government stuff. This was like Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman. This was a security world I had never experienced and had no earthly idea what these people were dealing with.
This is one of those things where we often talk about, you know, when you're speaking, you know, no one's going to die if you screw up. This is a place where there can be life and death on the line.
There can be, especially in their world. For me, though, I spent the entire time right up until the moment I took the stage just pulling people aside and asking them about their pain. What is it they deal with on a day-to-day basis and what hurts? And I actually crafted the entire presentation as I was walking up front. It was really interesting and fun. I made it my own. It was about creating a security culture in an organization, which is really where I specialize and what my business is about in large part. So I made it my own, but I used their pain as examples. And it was stories that I had just got that day and the next day from the crowd, which was wonderful.
So then that really can help with keeping them engaged when they can see that this is so directly applicable. How can you really tell when your audience is engaged?
There's, of course, the lean-ins, the laughs when you say something funny, the focus. I mean, these days, it's pretty easy to tell if the audience is engaged simply by how many of them are attempting to go through their phone, emails, and so forth while you're trying to talk. Another good one is a nice pause. If you can pause and you look around and everybody is right on the edge of their seat, that's a really sure sign that not only are they engaged, but you've got them. You've got them, and they're ready to go with you wherever you want to take them. I love that pause. And another great one is people don't often do eye contact properly. A lot of times they'll kind of scan the room, but if you can zero in on individuals, even for just a second or two, you don't want to stare them down and make them feel awkward. But if you can speak even for a second or two around individuals, if they think that you may look directly at them or talk directly at them, I guarantee you they're not pulling their phone out.
That pause and that that slowing down and taking those moments, being comfortable with that pause and with that silence can be really powerful, from landing a point, from checking in with the audience, to even avoiding some crutch words while you figure out what you want to say next.
For sure. For sure.
So we mentioned fire stories back in the very beginning. What is a fire story?
I am so glad you asked that question, Bill. What's come out of this internet and this ubiquitous data that we have all around is a speech to inform becomes a very difficult thing. We all have our defenses up. If you hear information that doesn't jive with the information that you have, rather than leaning forward and saying, "That's interesting, tell me more," we tend to have this sort of fight or flight moment where it's either, "Yeah, I totally agree with you on that," or, "No, you're an idiot, and let me tell you why." And so I started studying really what gets around our fight or flight response and how to engage with people more effectively. And I came across the research of a guy named Walter Fisher. He was the founder of this thing that he referred to as the narrative paradigm, which was really kind of a departure from the way things had always been. People always said, you know, your speech should have 80% or 70% logic, data, and then a small percentage of story, just to kind of support and add color to things, and then a little bit over here of sort of your ethical presentation, your, "Hey, yes, you can trust me, I know what I'm talking about." And what Walter Fisher actually said was, "Hey, really, it's not so much about the data, it's about the story that's involved, because that's what we connect with. If you tell a good story, not only does it bypass that fight or flight response and engage the audience, but we get to experience whatever it is that you have experienced. And that power not only triggers some nice connections in our brains that mirror the experience that you had, but also it triggers more in the long-term parts of your brain. It allows the information and the perspective that you pass to stick with somebody long-term." So what he was saying really is it should be more about the story and much less about the data. Right about that time, I was also into Simon Sinek. I don't know if you're familiar with him. He's a TED speaker.
I've got like 3 or 4 of his books on my to-read list.
There you go. And I was taken, as was everybody else pretty much, with his presentation on starting with why. And this idea of finding a company's why you do things. And that people buy not what you do, but why you do it. And I watched that and I said, "This is so fascinating and earth-shattering. Why aren't more businesses doing it?" Most businesses find that totally fascinating, and then they go back to doing what it is they have always done. And I said, you know, behind everybody's why is a story. And it's a story that inspired change. It's a story that for somebody, they realize that they can't do the same things in the same way that they always have done. And Simon Sinek even has his own fire story. He talks about it in this one great interview, and I'm sure he does in his books as well, about after 9/11 and so forth, and seeing all that carnage there. He was working for a very successful advertising firm, and at some point he decided what he was doing was stupid. And then he started another advertising firm, and that thing was being successful. And he said, "You know what? I still can't shake the feeling that what I'm doing is stupid." And it was this story that for him created his why, which, as it turns out, was helping other people find their why. And so I just sort of put a title, a definition of that, because I think we all have these moments in time that change our lives. And I call these fire stories. They're everything that has happened to us that has changed our perspective at a fundamental level. And I feel that it's the messages that we pull from these fire stories that are individual to us that need to be shared, forge infinitely stronger presentations. And they really make strong connections between the person up at the front of the stage giving the message and the audience that's out there. And it's a message that's a lifetime. People can carry it with them for a lifetime because there's a story that has value that made a change.
Awesome. And that's sort of, and those stories do go ahead and impact our lives in lots of different ways. We were talking before the call about, you know, the story of my stroke that I talk about a little bit on this show and more often in my other podcast, all about that stuff. But it's that stuff that has that fundamental moment of making you look at your life and seeing the world in a different way.
Absolutely true. It's those big moments. And a lot of people think, I've worked with a number of people who come to me with kind of hat in hand. They say, gosh, Jason, I just don't have any stories. If only I had a stroke, then I'd have a cool story like Bill does. Wait a minute. We don't all have to have survived cancer or a stroke or something like that to have a great story. One of the more remembered speeches that I ever gave was about finally coming to a point where I no longer got canker sores because I switched to a toothpaste that didn't have sodium lauryl sulfate in it. And I just gave a speech about that. And I talked about the pain of having those canker sores. I don't know if you've ever gotten those little white mouth ulcers in your mouth. And they're incredibly painful, especially when you speak for a living. And such a simple thing as switching toothpaste all but eliminated that in the blink of an eye and really changed my life. And I gave a speech about that. And for months afterwards, people would be in the checkout of their grocery store and they would buy toothpaste without sodium lauryl sulfate and they would snap pictures of it and email it to me and say, hey, look, I'm on board as well. Something so simple as toothpaste. So people come to me and they think a lot of times, well, I don't have a great story. Yes, you do. If you have a strong opinion, if you have a perspective that is dominant in your life, I guarantee you it is based on experience, not on data. Data can be changed with other and better data, but an experience you can't get around. It happened and it's fact for you. And so to share that out with other people becomes critically important to doing a life-changing presentation.
Absolutely. One of the things I encourage people to do is just at the end of the day, just try to write down 1 to 3 interesting things that happened to you that day or that you saw or that interested you in some way. Because there may be a story in there. You may not know why it is. You may not know what it is. But some point in the future, you can look back at that list and see, there's something in there that really made an impact on me.
You're right about that. And keeping some way that you can keep track of these stories, this information, becomes so critical, especially if you want to be an extemporaneous speaker like me, because they say, okay, go ahead and get up there and speak. And in the moment, like everybody else, like being a comedian, somebody says, hey, tell me a joke. And in that moment, they go, So you have to be prepared. And your preparation, just like you said, comes from every day things happen to us. Maybe making a note and thinking about it a little bit, saying, wow, I had a real strong feeling about this. I wonder where that came from. And if you do some digging and push through the layers, 9 times out of 10, you will come to a story. And it's an important story because it changed the course of your life, even if it's just toothpaste.
Right. So, I mean, you're talking about these fire stories and the importance of this. This makes a lot of sense when you're talking about, you know, getting up there to do a keynote, to set a culture for the company, to introduce yourself, to really drive some major new initiative, whatever it is. But what about in the day-to-day presentations at work? Maybe that weekly sales meeting that you have to speak at, maybe that your staff meeting, maybe just some of these other presentations you do on a regular basis. How can individuals use fire stories within those types of day-to-day presentations?
Well, that's an awesome question. And it's funny because most organizations, most companies that I've worked with have at some point gotten so tired of hearing awful presentations that they've structured them in such a way as to allow no creativity whatsoever. They'll send you a form and say, okay, I want you to stand up here and read this form to me. This is what I'm after. It's really not what we're after. Presentations should be there to gain understanding, should be there to gain a deeper connection. If you are a manager and you are hearing a presentation from your sales force just to get the numbers for the week, I mean, really, why can't that just be emailed to you? What are we really after? And what we're really after is, if you've ever been in sales management, you've been out of the field for a while, you're desperate to know what is actually going on out there. And so part of having good fire stories in day-to-day presentations is asking the right questions. You know, we want deeper understanding of what our clients are facing. We want deeper understanding of the challenges facing the field. We want deeper understanding of why marketing isn't giving the right sort of message to sales, or why operations is behind on delivering a product or project. We've gotten away from asking the right questions because most people aren't very good at presenting. So we say, all right, just the facts. Let's just get the data. And so what's been fun for me in the organizations that I work for is asking different, more challenging questions. I don't want to know precisely how many deals you're going to close next week, because you can just email that to me. I don't need a presentation on that. I want to know what your customers do. Why are customers in the South different from customers in the Northeast? How is the market changing where you are? What do you see as effective upcoming? When you start asking questions like that, you start getting better stories.
It's a way of actually understanding what the pivot table is trying to show.
Absolutely. What do your bosses, or whoever it is you're giving the presentation to, what do they really want to know? And I guarantee you, they're seeking understanding. They're seeking perspective. And the best way to transfer that is with a story. With a story with emotion, with conflict, with pain, whatever that is. Whatever your business happens to be, I guarantee you, if you are in business, you are solving some sort of pain, or you will very soon be out of business.
So you also mentioned doing generational communications and talking about that before you really got into helping folks craft and share their fire stories. I mean, what did those of us in Gen X really most need to know now about presenting to other generations?
Another great subject that I have spent a lot of my time on, helping people from different generations to connect is a super big challenge. We all have unique perspectives, and that's really what generations are about, is we all sort of grew up with our own set of circumstances and shared experiences that kind of shape values and the values of a generation. And a lot of times understanding what those are can make a better presentation. If you understand that baby boomers grew up in a time of hope, where they were excited about the system in general, but also making a difference, making a positive change in the system. Also some of the pain that that generation dealt with, for the first time having two genders in the workplace to compete with. How many people had higher education? So separating yourself from that. And then the sheer number of, call it, baby boomers that are out there, 78 million. You start to understand why they behave in some of the ways that they do. Why they're so competitive, for example, and that sort of thing. And so understanding where those different generations come from are really critically important to shaping how you can present to that to that generation in a way that they'll receive effectively. Same thing, of course, goes now with millennials. There's the largest generation in American history, and they're everywhere, and everybody's scrambling to try and figure out what these millennials are all about. And this is the most important generation for us to reach right now. And they're a pretty easy generation to reach once you understand what they're dealing with. This is a generation starving for connection. And they're going about it the wrong way, by the way. I think the numbers, as far as, I don't know if you read the recent report, that over the last 20 years, rates of depression, rates of anxiety, rates of loneliness, and rates of suicide are steadily up in the United States. Over the last 20 years across the country, basically, it's up 30%. And most people cite a lack of deep connection. Well, that's because we're attempting to do it all digitally. That's what speaking is about, whether it's one-on-one or one to a large group, is sharing this understanding, this deeper understanding, this deeper perspective. And it's that connection that all of us really, really crave.
I think it's also important, especially for those of us in Gen X, to feel a certain amount of sympathy for the generations that were not fortunate enough to grow up with the music of the 80s.
You know, I saw a wonderful presentation on VH1. They were talking about when metal ruled the planet. And it was all about those late 1980 music acts like Motley Crue and Poison and Skid Row and all of those. And they asked them this wonderful question that really gets to changing attitudes of a generation. You know, actually the 80s, they call a micro generation, they call them Generation Jones, kind of that Alex P. Keaton family ties generation there that faded into the 90s kind of darkness grunge generation. And so they asked, I think it was Bret Michaels, I'm just going off memory there, but they asked whoever the 80s star was, well, how come you didn't see the grunge movement coming? How come you didn't see Seattle coming? And they said, oh, we knew all about the Seattle music scene out there. We just never thought anybody would actually listen to it. We were singing about drugs and hooking up with girls and partying and staying out all late and drinking and all this. They were singing about sadness and depression and suicide. We were like, who would want to listen to that? And it turns out that that was the mood of the generation as it flowed into the 90s. That's where Generation X was. And that's what we were relating to. They just missed it.
It's interesting how that can be a real hallmark of what people are thinking about and feeling about, especially the youth when you look at music. And it really tells you a lot because it addresses what you talked about before. It doesn't give you the logical information and the data that used to be a part of traditional presentations. It gives you the storytelling and it gives you the emotional connection that folks are really thinking about, that even if they may not be aware of, you get that in the popular music in a way that you don't get from any academic presentation.
It's true. My son is 11 years old, and I think whereas most people, at least my parents' generation, right, it was always turn it down or turn that garbage off. I actually want to listen to what he's listening to. I want to hear what his generation is getting involved with, what they're feeling overwhelmingly, because at 11 years old, he is not a millennial. He's the next generation, what they call Generation Z or Homeland Generation, I think they now call them. A completely different attitude and a completely different world out there. And I'm fascinated to know what that's going to be like.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And I think what a lot of folks are overlooking too when they talk about millennials is that millennials are now in their entering their late 30s.
They are.
They're not the kids right out of college.
They are. And they're not all living in their parents' basement, thank goodness. It's some of them have great jobs and they're starting companies and they're changing the world. It's really cool to watch. They just did it a little later than most other generations, but it's really cool to watch.
Sure. Definitely. Definitely. So in talking about things that have been really cool to watch and participate in, what's really been the most personally rewarding talk that you've done, that you've participated in?
I've been thinking a lot about that question because each one is such a special experience in the moment. I think one of the greatest presentations really was, it was a company that I was working with. And it was a company that had been wildly successful. And this is sort of the blessing and the curse of the entrepreneurial world. And you were in technology, so I don't know if you were in an entrepreneurial experience, but
every time you're in technology, there's always an entrepreneurial element to it because you got to reinvent your job, even in the biggest corporation, every 3 to 6 months.
You're right about that. As you know, I was in the technology world as well, and it is changing so fast, it's hard to keep up with. But this was a company, actually not in the technology world, but it was one that had been wildly successful and had grown from just a handful of those people who were putting in the midnight hours. You know what I mean? They were burning the midnight oil, as they say. They were dedicated, and some of them had given up on their jobs and were working in this guy's kitchen and struggling and fighting to make the company go, and they were successful, and the company had blown up. And now all of a sudden, those handful of people that were sacrificed and given everything to the cause were disheartened because they walked around and they looked around and everybody was on Facebook. Everybody was surfing the net. Everybody was wasting time. Everybody was counting the minutes until it was time to check out. And as I talked to them, they said, you know, it's all of a sudden we've got a workforce full of people who are just trading hours for dollars. And that's not what we want. And I got to listening to them and listening to how they had shared their information with this ever-widening pool of employees. And it was all data. It was, well, here's what we're forecasting for the next thing. Here's what we're releasing the next deal. Here's how much money we made last term. Here, all things that were important to that core group of people who were in survival mode, trying to take that next step. But to all these new employees, they were no longer in survival mode. And so they really didn't care. It was nice to hear that the company was doing well, but they weren't giving them anything to really move the company. And so a great presentation that I didn't give it. It was a gift that I gave the CEO where I sat down with them and I pulled the fire story of their company out and made it compelling and exciting and brought out all the details and emotions. And they got up there and they told their story to a group of employees who hadn't heard it in years. And many of them didn't know it at all. And to see those people understand for the first time the kind of company they were working for and what their mission truly was inspiring to me. And I was in the unique position that I wasn't on the stage and I wasn't in the crowd. I was in the middle and I got to see both sides of it happen. And it was a magical moment.
Awesome. Well, that is fantastic. So, Jason, if folks want to know more about you and what you're up to, where should they go?
Several great ways. I am on Twitter at Your Fire Stories. Please feel free to connect with me out there. I post many times a day there. They can also go to my website, which is firestory.com.
Well, fantastic. We'll also have all of those links over at 2minutetalktips.com/Jason.
Thank you.
All right. So Jason, thanks so much for joining us today. This has been fantastic. I know I've learned stuff and I've had a lot of fun in the process.
Isn't that the best way to learn?
Absolutely.
When you're having a good time? Well, Bill, I can't thank you enough for reaching out and for having me on your show. I love what you're doing here. And I hope, first of all, that you keep sharing your fire story about your stroke and the effects that it had on your life. But another fire story is taking the step to start this program, to start this podcast. And I think it's super helpful. You're changing people's lives, and keep sharing that story as well.
Now that the school year has begun in the United States, speech and debate, or forensics, competitive speaking, is picking up again. It's a fantastic activity. It gave me my early training as a speaker, and really the time I spent in speech and debate in college is really the stuff from my college education that I still use today in my career and obviously in these shows too. It also helped Jason get started. And in fact, many of our previous guests got their start competing in forensics, including Hua, the spoken word artist we talked to from Nigeria, the senior vice president and general counsel for litigation at Walmart and courtroom graphics specialist Carrie Ruttenberg, and of course, Dr. Denise Vaughn from the University of Washington Bothell speech and debate team. And there have been many others. If a student expresses interest in speech and debate, be sure to encourage them. It may be the most valuable educational experience of their life, and it's not just about the technique of speaking. The lessons you learn through speech and debate, the lessons around thinking clearly, around understanding things, around personalizing and depersonalizing conflict, around breaking down concepts into their constituent parts, about exploring worlds of literature and poetry and figuring out how to share them with an audience, the skills you have to develop in comic timing and some of the more comedy-oriented activities. These are all key mental training activities that can apply so much more in the future. So if somebody expresses interest, be sure to encourage them to check out the speech and debate teams at their high school or college, or if they're really fortunate, even in the younger ages. So to learn more about Fire Stories, be sure to check out Jason's website and connect with him on his social channels. You can find all those links and more over at 2minutetalktips.com/firestory. Share this episode with 3 coworkers or relatives by giving them the link, 2minutetalktips.com/firestory. And of course, as always, don't get best, get better. Thanks a lot. I'm Bill Monroe, and I'll talk to you next week.
Two-Minute Talk Tips is a proud production of the Currently Speaking Podcast Network.